people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. While India reiterated its strong stance against terrorism and the threats South Asian region stares at during the Quad Summit and Prime Minister Narendra Modi's address to the United Nations General Assembly, the recent PM visit to the United States also emphasized at strengthening bilateral ties with different countries and ensuring more FDI in India. The Prime Minister held a number of meetings with state leaders and top CEOs to deepen both camaraderie and cooperation. Have a look.
Nearly 8 months after the current US dispensation came to office, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi held wide-ranging talks with the US leadership. The meeting that came in the backdrop of an unfolding crisis in war-torn Afghanistan purportedly discussed the regional effects of what appears to be a pug-backed devious plan. US Vice President Kamala Harris also welcomed India's decision to resume exports of the COVID-19 vaccine. India, the world's biggest maker of COVID vaccines, which has already inoculated over 850 million doses in the country, announced past week that it would resume vaccine exports later this year. India had earlier stopped exports in April to focus on inoculating its own population as infections exploded.
When India experienced a surge of COVID in the country, the United States was very proud to support India in its need and responsibility to vaccinate its people. And I welcome India's announcement that it will soon be able to resume vaccine exports. It is of particular note and admiration that India, I'm told, is currently vaccinating approximately 10 million people a day as of today.
The two sides acknowledge that their relationship has developed into a global strategic partnership. Regular exchange of high-level political visits has provided sustained momentum to bilateral cooperation. In past half decade, the trade ties have picked an unprecedented pace with annual figures expected to reach $100 billion in near future. Both India and the US have shown an increased confidence in each other ever since they had a fallout with China in one or the other form. Apart from trade, India has also shown an upped interest in US defense products, and the purchases have grown significantly high in past few years. Modi said India and the US are natural partners having similar geopolitical interests, and the two countries were continuously increasing cooperation between them.
विश्व की सबसे बड़ी और सबसे पुरानी डेमोक्रेसीज के रूप में भारत और अमेरिका नेचुरल पार्टनर है. हमारे मूल्यों में समानता है, हमारे जियोपॉलिटिकल हितों में समानता है और हमारा तालमेल और सहयोग भी निरंतर बढ़ता जा रहा है.
Modi also met his Japanese and Australian counterparts Yoshihide Suga and Scott Morrison on the sidelines. While all of them are now members of the Quad grouping, New Delhi's bilateral camaraderie with both Japan and Australia has grown stronger in recent times. Modi also met chief executives of several US companies including Qualcomm and Blackstone. They discussed ongoing projects and further investment opportunities in India, including under the National Infrastructure Pipeline and National Monetization Pipeline.
We see a lot of activity right now because of the necessity to geo-diversify and build a very resilient supply chain for semiconductors. We believe India could be an important destination, and if that infrastructure is available in India, we'll be very happy to partner with India.
While many global businesses have been thriving in India, many others have shifted their interest towards India, especially after the breakout of the pandemic. Last year, hundreds of them announced that they would be shifting their bases from China to India, providing a major boost not just to India's GDP and economy, but a confirmation to New Delhi's sustained efforts at making the Indian market more accessible and hospitable to foreign investors and manufacturers.
Moving on. While we have time and again highlighted the grim situation of Baloch and their struggle against Pakistan establishment, the other provinces barring Punjab haven't had a run of good fortunes either. Today we talk about Sindh, the most populated province of Pakistan, which is systematically discriminated against, for it is predominantly inhabited by Muhajirs, the people who migrated to the region in 1947. Altaf Hussain, a renowned Sindhi leader who was forced to leave Pakistan owing to state crackdown, has urged people to revive the movement of freedom from Islamabad and unite in the face of a despotic Pakistan.
Sindhis who have been subjugated and suppressed for decades will get their independence, and he will do anything to ensure that. The exiled Mutahida Qaumi movement leader Altaf Hussain has said in his periodic video address to the people of Sindh. His statements have come in the backdrop of a deteriorating economic and human rights situation in Sindh. The only obstacle he sees in attaining his goal of launching a massive anti-Pakistan drive is divisions within the Sindhi community. Where one side are the Muhajirs, the people who travelled to Pakistan from India during partition in 1947 and settled there, and the Sindhis who are the original natives. Hussain blamed, though there is a civilian government in Pakistan, the fact is that the whole country is under the control of the army. He also called on Sindhis to unite for the freedom of Sindh from military occupation.
हम सिंधु देश की आजादी के लिए बड़ी से बड़ी कुर्बानी देने के लिए तैयार हैं. सिंध हमारी धरती है. सिंधियों, खुदा के वास्ते आप समझो, हम सिंध को आजाद कराएंगे. आप और हम मिलके मोहब्बत के साथ, जैसे 1947 के बाद सिंधी महाजर मिलके रहते थे, सिंधियों ने बहुत मदद की, उसी तरह से मिलके रहेंगे. इसलिए अब लड़ाई नहीं होगी सिंधी और महाजरों में कि सिंधु देश में कोई न जागीरदार होगा न वडेरा होगा.
It's not that Pakistan is faring better at any economic indicator, but Sindhis are among those who are deliberately denied rights. From political ostracization to orchestrated obstacles keeping them at bay from the mainstream, the Sindhi nationalists have been targeted at all levels. They have been at the receiving end of state discrimination and repression. Their fundamental rights are restricted to official papers only. The freedom of speech is muzzled brutally, and the press, which is supposed to highlight human rights violations, operates at whims and fancies of political leaders and army generals. And all this has ended up in shattering all development indicators of the region. While Sindh is the most populated province of Pakistan, its GDP is not even half of Punjab. Educational sector is in shambles. Natives blame Islamabad for not meeting even their basic requirements. And the unemployment rate in the region is alarmingly high. Altaf Hussain and other Sindhi nationalists who are not ready to settle for anything less than a separate state called Sindhu Desh have urged people to unite against an authoritarian Islamabad.
Hey Sindhiyo, tum saath do Altaf Hussain ka to bahut achha hoga kyunki hum kitna hi lade महाजन और सिंधी उर्दू स्पीकिंग सिंधी और सिंधी स्पीकिंग सिंधी हमें लड़ लड़ के कत्ले आम के बाद बहुत जानी हमें फिर मिलके बैठना होगा क्योंकि हमारी अब कोई दोनों की सिंध के अलावा जमीन नहीं है लिहाजा इत्तेहाद कर लो।
The grievances of both Sindhi and Mohajirs are largely directed at the Punjabis who dominate the bureaucracy and the armed forces. There is a common concern expressed by Sindhis and Mohajirs on several issues, including the lack of regional and provincial autonomy and continuous interference from Islamabad in the affairs of Sindh. Sindhis and Mohajirs also demand a ban on further settlements of Punjabis in Pakhtuns and insist that restrictions should be placed on the sale of properties and allotment of businesses to those not domiciled in the province. They also accuse the Pakistan Army of engineering the riots amongst Mohajirs and Sindhis to deepen the fault lines. Sindhi nationalists, however, have appealed to people to unite in order to strengthen their movement. And the current situation could just prove to be conducive for them as global eyes are on Pakistan, especially after its role in the return of Taliban in neighboring Afghanistan.
Moving on. People in Afghanistan, a global news hotspot where the danger of a humanitarian crisis loomed large, are going through a turbulent phase. From jobs to food and medicine to shelter, more and more Afghans are losing their basic security covers with each passing day. Trade has declined substantially, hospitals are running short of staff, and not just COVID vaccination, the country has failed at inoculating other essential jabs too. Displacement coupled with unemployment has demoralized common Afghans with no light appearing at the end of the tunnel.
Hundreds of trucks can be seen stranded on roads leading to Afghan-Pakistan border as the trade between the two sides has been hit severely since Taliban swept to power in Kabul. Officials call it a ripple effect of the militant rule in Afghanistan and the economic consequences it brought along, including the frozen bank accounts of Afghanistan money by the US. Only a handful of them who are in business of fruits and vegetables have been profitable and moving around for it a season in the war-torn country. The others are dejected and hopeless. Pakistan government, which backs Taliban rule, has tried to spin a narrative of everything good at the border, but pictures signal an emerging crisis that can further push back Afghanistan's economy.
Our import ko der zyada ra rawan de import ko takriban 300-350 pore gaadi dd base bande rauzi import khopak ke matlab der miqdar de perishable items di chukum da angur tomato pyaaz badrang da shin ra rawan de import ke.
An already weak health system of countries on the verge of collapse as shortage of doctors and nursing staff has cropped up, following several of them fleeing and women restricted by Taliban's Sharia orders. World Health Organization Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus visited doctors, hospital staff and trauma patients at a Kabul hospital and said the country was facing an acute shortage of both medicines and vaccination doses amidst the instability. He said that cases of infant disease polio, which was close to be eradicated in the country, could make a reappearance in the country.
Over the past 20 years, significant health gains have been made in Afghanistan in reducing maternal and child mortality, moving toward polio eradication, and more. Those gains are now at severe risk, with the country's health system on the brink of collapse. There has been a surge in cases of measles and diarrhea. Almost 50% of children are at risk of malnutrition. The resurgence of polio is a major risk, and 2.1 million doses of COVID-19 vaccine remain unused.
Tedros has also urged international community to come forward to help, but many of them have been reluctant owing to the crisis. Meanwhile, internally displaced Afghans staying in the capital Kabul said their hopes of getting back their jobs and homes were diminishing. Donors have so far pledged more than $1.1 billion to help Afghanistan, but that does not seem to have the caliber to evacuate country from deep crisis. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees has said that more than 18 million Afghans, or about half the Afghan population, required humanitarian aid before the Taliban took over. More than 3.5 million Afghans were already displaced in a country that is battling drought and the COVID-19 pandemic. Poverty has spiraled across Afghanistan since the country fell to militants, and in words of UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres, Afghans are facing perhaps their most perilous hour.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headlines this week.
The Israeli forces have caught the last two of the six Palestinian militants who tunneled out of a maximum security Israeli jail nearly 2 weeks ago in an escape that embarrassed Israel's security establishment but delighted Palestinians. They were remanded by an Israeli court later in the day. The two members of the Islamic Jihad militant group were apprehended before dawn from a house in the Palestinian city of Jenin in West Bank. The other four were captured in pairs a week ago near the Arab city of Nazareth in northern Israel. All six have either been convicted or are suspected of planning or carrying out deadly attacks on Israelis. The six Palestinians, who broke out free on September 6, had tunneled a hole through their prison cell. Israeli officials say they will investigate any lapses that allowed their escape. Chopstick has been used by people for more than 3,000 years in Japan. But in this kindergarten in Tokyo, there is a new experience for children who enjoy using them while eating their meals. The start of using chopstick in Japan is a mystery. Some people say it came from China, but Japanese people have perfected using it for many purposes and have even special culture and custom related to them. This company has been making handmade chopstick for over 100 years, and they have good advice about how to choose the best chopstick size to fit the hand.
これの 1.5 倍、1アタ半
There are many shapes and designs for chopsticks, and it is up to the customer to choose the one that matches their taste and feel. There is also a special foldable set of chopstick. Another interesting thing about these chopsticks is that it is made by recycled baseball bat. And to promote the use of chopstick culture, there is a special association of chopstick teachers who visits a school to teach children the right way to use it
as they are part of Japanese culture and important item to enjoy Japanese traditional food and cuisine, washoku. These vintage motorcycle collectors in Ichinomiya in Aichi Prefecture are dedicated towards their passion for riding river motorcycles. Although they are uncomfortable to ride and are less safe than modern bikes, love for these vintage items hasn't faded. All the maintenance and repair work of these bikes are done at the home garage, largely because majority of these motorcycle manufacturers have already withdrawn from business or have closed down. As a result of this, replacement parts are no longer available. Thus, many parts of these bikes are made manually, and when motorcycle needs repair, it may take months to fix it.
え、一番大変なのは、まあ、アメリカのバイクですので、え、日本には部品がないですから、え、アメリカで部品を探して取り寄せて直すってところが一番難しいですね。で、特にこの インディアンの 20年代はなかなかアメリカでもパーツがなくてですね、直すのにちょっと苦労をするって形ですね。はい。Only
starting an engine involves a variety of operations, and the operation of these motorbikes depends on personal skills. These motorbikes escaped war retaliation and have survived to the present day. The collectors of these bikes say driving these bikes requires the use of all five senses, and their vehicles give them a different level of experience. People are surprised to see these rare motorbikes on the street, which are typically placed in museums.
Moving on. Hindus in Nepal celebrate the true spirit of life through several unique festivals and rituals every year. These festivals are a reflection of country's glorious heritage and diverse culture and traditions. One such ritual is Kumari Puja, where pre-adolescent girls are worshipped as goddesses to ward off evil. Have a look.
A boundless Hindu culture is manifested in forms and rituals that are not just aesthetically astounding, but reflect an entrenched value system that respects and treats everybody equally. The same system has defined a unique place of children in the society, and they are considered incarnations of gods. Whether it is India or Nepal, a girl child is worshipped on several occasions across the year. Kumari Puja is one such occasion where pre-adolescent girls are revered and celebrated as deities. Donned in red robes, jewelry, elaborate accessories, and tattooed with traditional colors, these pre-adolescent girls, who are considered goddess Durga, are worshipped to mark the festival of Kumari Puja. The tradition is believed to ward off bad luck, diseases, and evil forces.
जुन हामीले प्रार्थना गर्छौं भगवानसँग कि यो बच्चाले केही पनि नहोस्, कसैको आँखा नलागोस्, रोग व्याधि नहोस् हामी कामना गर्छौं। त्यसको साथ चाहिँ हामीले पनि कामना गरिरहेका हुन्छौं। र यो कुमारी पूजा भनेको तीन विधिले हुन्छ। हिन्दू, बुद्धिस्ट, तान्त्रिक तीन विधिले यो कुमारी पूजा हुन्छ। र यो कुमारी पूजा गर्नाले चाहिँ यो कुमारी पूजा गराएका बच्चाहरूलाई कुनै पनि रोग व्याधि लाग्दैन।
Usually, the girls under 7 years of age participate in the tradition, for they are believed to be the earthly incarnations of divine feminine energy and manifestations of the goddess Taleju, the Nepalese name for Hindu goddess Durga. The ritualistic tradition is held annually in the Himalayan nation and is the main significance among its Nevari community. During this 8-day-long festival, a young Nevari girl is chosen to represent the goddess Kumari as an incarnation of goddess Taleju, the tutelary deity of the Malla dynasty and the Shah dynasty, which inherited the tradition. Now a popular tradition, the festival is witnessed by a number of people from around the country every year.
Kumari Puja is the tradition of worshipping young prepubescent girls as manifestations of the divine female energy or Devi in Asian religious traditions. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.